This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK, sponsored by Prudy Insurance. Now, from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Today's show brought to you by Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. Auto, home, life, business, boat, RV, motorcycle, bundles. They'll make sure that you are fully insured, but also do everything they can to save you money because customer service means everything to them. They're the pros in insurance. It's Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. And we're in the Sunbury Motors studio, Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia, Routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, online at sunburymotors.com. Time now for our play-by-play call of the day.
And this core group, as I mentioned earlier, 12 seasons together. They've been together forever. Uh-oh, Curry loses Brooks, not once, but twice. And then he makes another one. His fourth three. My goodness.
Recovered to help, but look at Steph Curry here dancing on Dylan Brooks. Gets Dylan in the air, and yeah, he's just clowning at this point.
And made him look bad on that. That's our play-by-play call of the day. Time to bring in now the outstanding Nate Bauer. Sir, always a pleasure. Welcome.
Hey, what's going on? Thanks for having me.
Yeah, it's great to have you on the show, and thanks for jumping in when you did today. That's fabulous. How entertaining was it as you were going through the comments section on Saturday?
You know, we had a few run-ins, I would say. Everybody kind of has their position dug in at this point. But look, I think that there's a certain element of this of just maybe how you perceive the world, right? Like just what your vantage point is on things. And it isn't to say that one thing is right or more right, you know, than the other. Like, you could come out of that game as a Penn State fan and be despondent, even in a win. I get it. I'm not discounting that at all. There were lots of things to gripe about and feel as though they weren't up to the standard that Penn State wanted. And certainly Penn State, after the game, right, to a man, James Franklin, the players themselves, all said that, right, more or less. But there's another side of things that you could look at that game and say, hey, they've lost that game before under mm-hmm. James Franklin, right? Like mm-hmm. that is a sure. game that Penn State has. It is black and white, right? Like this is a game that, coming off of the first loss of the season, Penn State has lost a second game within 1 week or 2 weeks, 8 of 9 years of all the stuff that people talk about with him. Excuse me. It's the most legitimate criticism is that his teams have a very, very hard time recovering. But instead of actually losing it, they won the game this week.
I'll get to that in a moment. There's something that I said at the end of the pregame show when we were outside taking questions and comments from fans. And I said, the one thing I appreciate overall, and I'm sure you see this on a daily basis in what you do, is that you want a passionate, engaged fan base. You don't want an apathetic one. And yes, and while you get bombarded with stuff during the game, or you get not bombarded, but get asked a lot of questions in a pregame after a loss especially, or, you know, the standard's the standard, and did you meet the standard? I appreciate the fact that the fans are so passionate about it, because an apathetic fan base, you're in trouble.
Totally. There's no doubt about that point. It is good. Like, this is funny, because after the Ohio State game, right, my entire week was spent just talking about things, right? And one of the things that's interesting to me, talking about what I feel like I do well specifically, is I'm not in defense of James Franklin or his record or anything else. That's not my role. That's not what I do. That's not what my obligation is. My defense is of reality and the truth, right? And so for as many 1-12 against top five teams, as is out there, right? These graphics that you see, the people that talk about this abysmal record against top five. Well, there's context that's needed to things like that, right? Ryan Day being 2-6 against top five teams seems relevant. Jim Harbaugh, 2-7, right? Right? Like, there are comps out there to say, look, there are other things that happen outside of the sphere of Penn State football that, while it's easy, it's like fast food. Yeah, I'm upset as a Penn State fan because of this loss. Absolutely, that's warranted. You get why fans feel that way. But it's just important to look at this with clear eyes and to say, okay, this is how you feel. These are the numbers that you're looking at. These are the storylines and the narratives that you're looking at. But also, hang on a second, some of this isn't exactly what meets the eye, and it's important to talk about it in that context.
Yeah, your job is to work for on3.com and deliver perspective. You're not working for Penn State. You're just reporting on what you're seeing.
Correct. And look, it's so funny to me because I don't think, and certainly this isn't my position, I don't think anybody within Penn State, even James Franklin himself, would argue that they're happy with the last 10 years in terms of getting over the hump. Would most people going into his tenure have been happy with the number of New Year's Six bowls, a Big Ten championship? If you could say that 10 years ago, given the situation that the program was in, most people overwhelmingly would have been happy with that. But that doesn't mean that they can be or should be happy now. People want more. You get it. That, like you said at the beginning, if your fan base doesn't want that and isn't like yearning for that, you're never going to get there. So that's an important piece and component of it, but also there just has to be some perspective about the success and what it means to have been able to do as much as has been done to this point in his tenure.
In talking with James and the players after the game, and then by your own observation, you brought up an interesting point. The standard is the standard. Where did they feel? And then in your observation, where did you feel where it was not the – they won, but wasn't the standard?
That's – see, here's where things get interesting for me, because it's – I think that James said it and a few players said it, but not enough fans are saying it or even media are saying it. Indiana played a great game.
Yes, they did.
That quarterback had a great game. His receivers made great plays for him. Like, that was – they just played well. So can you argue and look at the blown coverage and say, yeah, defensively that shouldn't happen? Absolutely. That's fine. There are plenty of those things. Certainly offensively, they again struggled to really find what I would call consistency from drive to drive, right? They had – very successful possessions, right? They had the same kind of drawn out 10, 11, 12 play type touchdown drives, but they were sandwiched around brain outs, right? And stuff where things just were not clicking the way that you would expect against a team of Indiana's caliber. It's just that I think that that's a little bit shorting the reality of what Indiana is, which is fairly good defensively, has been fairly good defensively for years, and is again this year fairly good defensively, up against Penn State's weakness, which we know is their offense. And then, you know, Manny Diaz's defense just didn't have a great day. But also, and importantly, those last 5 minutes, to me, feel defining in a lot of ways. Right, when they have not been tested, this team has not been tested in that manner for most of the season. They really have not had many of those experiences. You can point to Ohio State, but Ohio State was very one-sided. I mean, I think that we can all acknowledge that. this game being back and forth, you're in the heart of it, and when you needed to make plays, you got them on both sides of the ball. And for me, especially like when looking at this from 50,000 feet, that was especially important coming off of the dynamic of that Ohio State game, right? Because you had a team in a locker room that was in some way split by how that game played out, right? Defense feeling resentful over the fact that the offense couldn't kind of get it together. Well, guess what? Tables were turned in this one, where the defense let things happen and the offense needed to come around and put up a play. I mean, really worked seesaw, right? Defense getting the stop after Drew Aller's interception. Aller and Keandre, and obviously Katron Allen's role in getting that touchdown off of that, and then deny, right? Making kind of that that game sealing play to end it.
I opened up the show, and then I want your perspective on this. About this was one of those where you sit back and in the end, let's talk about how they won, right? Okay, we all know how they got to the point where they needed to do some things to win. That's been talked about a lot, but how did they win? And to me, this had a lot to do with winning situational football. They get a takeaway and points at the end of the half. They then start the second half, fifth time this season in eight games, they get a drive, get a touchdown out of the locker room. Okay, so they win the middle eight, 17-0. They needed on quick change to keep the damage to a minimum. They give up just a field goal. They then get the plays to Allen to get the two-minute drive going, hit the big play. Deny gets the fumble recovery, or gets the strip. It leads to the safety. Oh, and by the way, then they get the onside kick. Oh, and then by the way, they get a first down and they end it on their terms. All those situations they worked on and work on all the time, they won all those, and they won them when they needed them. That's how I looked at it in terms of how they won, because we know about pretty much how they got to the point where they needed to do it. What's your thought on that?
Yeah, no, I'm in complete agreement. And the thing that I'm looking at and debating myself in terms of how hard to hammer it is Mike Yurcich, right? For as much flack as he has taken last week, and in some cases deservedly so, to call that shot, I mean, what kind of tendency breaker is that, right? To call that shot and to have that play executed in that moment, I don't feel like anybody's really talking about that, but it feels to me like a very important component to look at and remember in how that game played out, right? There was more than enough time for them to go 10 yards at a pop down the field there in the fourth quarter.
Yeah.
But they didn't, right? They gave it a shot. They took that chance, and not just a chance, but something that very clearly was something that felt to me changed about this week, right? There was more usage of the middle of the field in the passing game. There was more patience, I feel like, on Drew Aller's part to not just look down the field, but not check down quite as quickly as I feel like he has in past weeks, right? It's a balance. It's always a balance there. But it just felt like there were some strides, as hard as it might have been to see at some times, it felt like there were some strides there made offensively in this game for that team.
Yeah, because, I mean, look, Indiana will do a few things where, you know, we always hear about cover two, cover three, so forth. There are times where Indiana played cover six in the game. And for the most part, Drew didn't take the bait on it. But when they got the touchdown play, they went man. Yep. And as soon as they saw it, they went for it. And I thought that was a key read by everybody, by Mike, by Drew, by Keandre Lambert-Smith. The three of them read it right.
Yep. Yeah, 100%. And it ended up being something that it's just a question for me right now of, is this the type of performance that can propel them into next week? To me, it's fairly clear. I would say yes, but you just have to see, right? How much of that game, if it's 85% of the game, right, until those final 5 minutes of, you know, kind of middling right? You don't come away feeling great about the performance otherwise for those 55 minutes. If you can take those last 5 minutes and turn it into something good and feel positive about it and have some momentum, I mean, that's just something that, I don't know, feels to me has been lacking at a lot of points this season. Even when they've blown teams out, they haven't really looked that way, the way that they did in those last 5 minutes for the majority of the season.
Have you given any thought yet about the Maryland game and Talia Tungavaiola and company?
Yeah, I mean, I think certainly the defense is going to have to kind of get it together. I mean, I think that it's fine to have an off week. It's just a question of, right, is this a wake-up call, right? Because I think, you know, maybe you're feeling yourself a little bit after Ohio State. You feel really good about what you were able to do and frustrated, certainly, that the offense wasn't able to hold up its end of the bargain. But, hey, guess what? Indiana just exposed you. That, you know, exposed is a strong word, but you know what I mean. It was a little bit of a step back, and so it will be important against a team in Maryland that scores points. Whether they've won or lost has kind of been beside the point. They're going to put up points. They've done it all year. So it will be important for both of those elements, right? The defense has to get back to the standard that it has had, and certainly there's no reason to believe that it can't. But also the offense is going to have to go into this game with a mindset of keeping up, right, or being in front of. You can't go into this game thinking that you're going to score 17 points and win. It's just not going to happen, right? Like that's not the style of game that Maryland's going to play against you. So it'll be interesting to see what happens.
Finally, basketball opens on Monday when they take on Delaware State. Any thoughts about what this team can be like?
That's a great question. I'm happy that you didn't ask me about Delaware State, because my scout has not started on them.
Oh, well, it's okay, because they've got 8 returning guys. I actually have a decent handle on them. We're all right.
Okay, well, I'm gonna see you on Wednesday, and we can talk about that then. No, I think look, ace is ace, and I think that's the point that I had. I don't know about doubts, but maybe some reservations about the climb into this level for him. That much is clear, right? He is a dude, and that was evident in the Bahamas. It was evident in the quote-unquote secret scrimmage against Villanova. It was again on Friday night. Like he's that guy. I certainly will continue to be monitoring Puff Johnson. I think he really changes the type of team that they are.
Totally agree.
His situation is going to be really important. Leo O'Boyle, his situation is going to be important, right? So those two guys and seeing where they are at the beginning of the season is going to be interesting. But also, whether they're there or not when they fire off the line here next week, you still see the elements of a team that, look, they're going to take a bunch of three-pointers. They're going to push the pace for volume shots, just in general. They want volume looks at the basket. So, you know, it will, I think, be, I don't want to say ugly, but, right? I mean, I think that you can see that there's going to be a little bit of a roller coaster element to this season. But also the pieces are there. That if they can figure out perimeter defense, I think they will be able to be a team that pushes it and plays kind of an exciting brand of basketball. We'll see.
Always a pleasure, my friend. Great analysis as always.
Hey, thanks so much for having me. I appreciate it.
Nate Bauer on 3.com and Blue White Illustrated. All right, we'll take a break. Rich Scarcella, final half hour. Great to have you with us today. Brought to you by Purdy Insurance on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Okay. It was all quiet for the most part, on the Michigan front over the weekend. They didn't play. They've got Purdue this week. It's the primetime game on Saturday on NBC. We'll see what happens, what's reported this week. on what's going on. I will say this. It is mushroomed in a short period of time, which I found to be interesting. I believe it is now alleged that when the NCAA went in last Thursday to interview the Michigan coaches, that Jim Harbaugh, it is alleged, sent them all out recruiting. Great. I don't think that's what anybody wanted to see there. But that's what's alleged. Rich Scarcella, next half hour, Reading Eagle. As we continue here on News Radio 1070 WKOK, brought to you by Purdy Insurance.
This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK, sponsored by Purdy Insurance. Now, from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. Auto, home, life, business, boat, RV, motorcycle. Whether it's individual policies for each or bundles, they'll do everything they can to save you money while making sure you're fully insured. Customer service means everything to them. They are the pros in insurance. All at Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. And we're in the Sunbury Motors studio, Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia, Routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. Anytime you want to go out and get really terrific analysis of something, you turn to somebody like Rich Scarcella from the Reading Eagle. Rich, always a pleasure. Great to have you with us.
Steve, it's my pleasure. Thanks for having me.
So, Rich, let's start with this. It's a game that that featured plenty of ups and downs. So as you watched it during the game, James Franklin will talk about the standard is the standard. And I know that afterward he talked about the standard. Some of the players did as well. So in what areas does he feel or the players feel, and then your observation, where they didn't meet a standard on Saturday?
Well, let's start with the defense, which has played superbly all season. The breakdowns on the first two touchdown passes that Indiana threw, Brendan Sorsby, there was a breakdown. Whether it was communication, whether it was a blown assignment, whatever. You haven't seen that all year. And I'm sure that's eating alive at one defensive coordinator named Manny Diaz, and also Terry Smith and Anthony Poindexter. I'm sure that's bothering them, and I'm sure it's bothering the players. I like to say, I know James, said nobody wants to hear it, but I think part of it is it was an emotional letdown. There's no doubt about that in my mind. You lose focus, you lose concentration, and those things happen. Offensively, I think they've got to run the ball, find a way to run the ball in a more productive manner. I get asked, of course, since Nick Singleton is from Berks County, the Reading area, what's wrong with Singleton? Is he getting enough carries? Or, what's wrong with the running game? Here's the number, Steve, that may knock your socks off, but I don't think – well, won't you, because you're on top of everything. Against Illinois, Northwestern, and Indiana, the three worst rushing defenses in the Big Ten, Penn State averaged 3.5 yards a carry.
Right.
That has to be better. That has to be better. What are the reasons behind that? We've talked about, is it because the lack of explosive plays in the passing game, defense is crowding the box, so on and so forth. But that has to change.
And there's no question it has to change along the way, because those are games where you expected Penn State to reasonably, they could get between 180 and 220 with the running backs they have, and they did not get to those level in any one of those three games along the way. So now let's flip the switch for a moment. And in flipping the switch, that would be, right, because they've been in this spot before over the years and have not won this game. right? Well, they won the game.
Yeah.
So let's discuss, before we get to other parts, how they won the game. And to me, they do a lot of work on situational football. Mm-hmm. So the end of the first half, they win the final 4 minutes 10-0, mm-hmm. including a takeaway, mm-hmm. a field goal. Fifth time in eight games they come out, they start the second mm-hmm. half with a touchdown drive.
Yeah.
So that's 17. All right. You get to the last few minutes of the game, and they get quick change. They talk about that all the time. They gave up three. Mm-hmm. They then go through the drive. Think about how the drive started, the two Allen plays. Okay, and then they get the man. Then you get the lead. You want your defense to protect. They get the takeaway and the 2 points. Oh, it's not done yet. It's going to be an onside kick. They get it because they executed it right. Then they close out with a first down, so they closed it out on their terms. Those are all situations that they work on, and they checked all those boxes when they needed to. Does that tell you anything? Am I wrong about anything I said, by the way?
No, you're not wrong at all. They did things in those last, after Drew's interception, after Drew Aller's interception, he admits, wrong play, you know, committed the cardinal sin of a quarterback, throwing the ball late over the middle, under pressure. But from that point on, they did everything right. Everything. You hit it on the head, Steve. You know, the two plays to Katron, the run and a pass, gained 21 yards, and it sets up the slot fade to Keandre Lambert-Smith, who had a step on the defender, and Drew Aller made a perfect pass. Yeah, I mean that, and this, and I wrote, and I noticed some other people on the beat wrote, this could be the turning point, the tipping point, however you want to put it, for the Penn State offense, for Drew Aller going forward. I will go back to a play in the first half, and maybe you agree, maybe you disagree. I thought there was a play where he improvised, and he hasn't done a lot of improvisation in the pass game. He rolled left, and he threw to Nick Singleton, who was wide open down the middle for a 28-yard gain.
Huge play.
And I think that set up his score. And I thought that was a big step forward for Drew. And I think this, like, I think also, as Keandre Lambert-Smith said after the game, the fact that Drew has thrown his first interception might not be the worst thing in the world. He threw it, and the world didn't end. So maybe there's a little bit of pressure taken off. You know, maybe, you know, whether it's him, whether it's play calling, whatever, hey, maybe we could take a few more chances. You know, hey, and if he throws an interception, so be it. I don't know. Only Drew and the coaches know that for sure.
Yeah, one of the tougher things I've found over the years, whether it's football or basketball, is when you're in the spot where you're the, quote, prohibitive favorite, and everybody knows you are.
Yep. Yeah,
is when you bring losing into the equation. Mm-hmm. How do you react?
Great point. Let's face it, the
game's 24-24. You brought losing into the equation, and your evaluation of the reaction when losing was brought into the equation because they won by nine.
Yeah, no, no doubt about it. Like you mentioned, like I said, the last 3 minutes of the game, they did everything correctly, perfectly. From the first two plays to Allen, the touchdown pass, and then you're right, the defense getting a three and out. We can argue that Tom Allen played it a little conservatively, but they had success running the football in the second half. So, but defense got the stop, forced the field goal, and then everything went Penn State's way. Not that they created their own breaks, and denied Dennis Sutton's play was capped at all.
Something I talked about when I went around speaking to groups, when people would ask me about the team, I'm not going to tell them that, hey, they're awesome and incredible here, but I talk about personnel and what they have so people know who to watch for mostly. And I said, to me, it was the deepest team that I've seen here since 2008.
Mm-hmm.
When you see the various guys who had to play in the game, you know, Drew Shelton had to play a lot at right tackle. Ioannis had to fill in tonight. Dennis Sutton. Is that it? What kind of role is depth playing with this football team right now?
Well, I would agree with you. I mean, I think many of you, me, and many others who have covered the team for a long time, this is a really deep team, And you lose a Chop Robinson. You lose a Caden Wallace during the game. You lose a Trey Wallace during the game. Mm-hmm. You have, you know, you lost Landon Tangwell right before camp. These are all starters I'm talking. We're not talking about second team or third team. We're talking about starters. And Penn State has managed to make up for those losses, not just in the first seven games, but also on Saturday. You know, Drew Shelton was able to rely on the experience he got last year playing in those last five games. You know, we saw Jameel Lyons get more snaps than he has. He's a true freshman. That's only going to help him going forward. And, you know, J.B. Nelson came back, and, you know, Ione got, you know, he's gotten some good reps. It's only going to help him going forward. So, yeah, I think the depth on this team is as good as I can remember.
When you look at the running game, and you were mentioned that people have asked you because Nick Singleton's from your area about it, is it a question of getting a second-level block, or is it even a question maybe of, okay, they're getting through, but they've got that one last tackler to beat? What are you seeing on a consistent basis?
Man. I see not a ton of room inside for either Singleton or Allen. I have seen, I don't know, I saw maybe one or two runs Saturday that Nick came, well, including the kickoff return, it was multiple. One tackle away from going all the way. I think he had a run like that, too. I can't remember what run it was. I think it was early in the game on Saturday. Sometimes you feel like it's a matter of time before it happens. You know, obviously there's nothing wrong with Catron Allen or Nick Singleton. You know, Catron ran really, really well Saturday.
Yes, he did.
Nick ran well in spots, and then the kickoff return. I mean, these two guys, I don't think there's anything wrong with them. I just think, you know, for some reason, Steve, I just don't think there's as much room to run as there was last year. And, you know, the only change on the offensive line is really Juice Scruggs is in the NFL. And, you know, there's only one new starter. So, you know, I can't, you know, I'm not smart enough to say they're not doing this right. They're doing this wrong, whatever. But I just know it just feels like there's just not as much room, not as many cracks as there were last year.
In the answer, you a couple of times referenced Nicholas Singleton's kickoff return of 50 yards. What have you seen in the improvement of special teams as time has gone, and what kind of difference can it make in the stretch run if it continues to make those incremental improvements?
You know, everybody's been focused on the issues on offense. The special teams has made probably has made the biggest in-season improvement of the three segments of the game. And Saturday was a very good day, except the blocking in the back penalty, wiping out Daquan Hardy's long punt return for a touchdown, which would have been really something. But I've seen you can see improvement. I think both kickers, I mean, okay, Alex Falcons missed a 51-yard field goal. I'll never hammer somebody for that. But he made a 50-yard field goal. Riley Thompson averaged 49 yards a punt. They got a turnover. K.J. Winston recovered a muff punt. Nick Singleton's 50-yard return, kickoff return. So yeah, I think the special teams, with the exception of the penalty on Hardy's return, had a very good day.
In fact, I'll point something out quickly about the Falcons' field goal he made. Remember, he made it after a penalty moved them back.
Yeah,
and and again, to his credit, mentally strong enough to say so what, and you know, I'll kick it from 50. I mean, because it was a 10-yard penalty, so he kicked it from 10 yards further back.
Yeah, that's a good point. And that gave them the halftime lead.
Yeah.
And, you know, gave them a little bit of momentum going into the locker room. And, you know, we talked about the first, you know, the final eight of and the first eight and or final four and the first four, yep. The middle eight, and they've done a really good job with that. So you know, but yeah, I really, you know, you look at the NFL, Steve, yeah. And this is I'm comparing like look at yesterday. How do you explain Denver beating Kansas City badly, really badly?
Yeah.
How do you how are the Cowboys just crushing the Rams or? I'm trying to think of another score that you, and then you look. Denver. Let's stick with Denver. Denver gave up 70 points to Miami this season,
yeah.
And shut down Patrick Mahomes in Kansas City. Yeah. It's, you know, football. It's funny, and I think especially in college, when you're dealing with 18 to 22 year olds or whatever, however you want to put it, you know, it was only natural they were going to. They weren't going to be emotionally up for that game on Saturday. That's taking nothing away from Indiana. Indiana played a really physical, tough, hard game.
Yeah.
But there were mental mistakes made by Penn State that allowed it to be a contest. There's no question about that. You know, and that might have been their hiccup, and they were able to survive it.
And again, how do you explain, for example, that? Detroit can win on opening night over Kansas City.
Yeah.
But get blown out by Baltimore.
I mean, right.
It's just like on the pro level, there are certain things that happen too. You sit back and go, Really? And you know, look, last year, forgotten in all of the greatness of Georgia last year was the fact that 5 minutes to go at Missouri, they're losing.
Mm-hmm.
And they won the game. Everybody forgot about that game. You know, even in the history of Penn State, 94, everybody remembers being down 21-0 in Illinois. But people forget in 86, they played this exact same game with Cincinnati and needed a late touchdown. And then got a safety to win the game in a season where you won at Alabama, won at Notre Dame, and beat Miami. I mean, these games, you do have this game during the season. Yes. Everybody does.
Yeah, yeah. And Georgia had one even earlier in this season.
Yep, yep.
Was it against Kentucky?
South Carolina.
South Carolina, thank you. But no, you're exactly right. It's funny you said that because that's exactly what was going through my mind in the second half Saturday was the Cincinnati game in '86. I was thinking of the same thing. And you do have these games, and you're able to survive them, and you learn from them, and you move on. And now you know what you did wrong. And now you're going down to Maryland, where a lot of the players on the Penn State roster are from, playing a team that's hurting a little bit. But Penn State expects a battle, and I think mentally they're going to be ready for the rest of the season.
Because for Maryland, this is their line in the sand game. I mean, that's how I'm looking at it with them. But you're right. That's a big game for them coming up. You know, and they know what's on the horizon after that. But history is a great teacher. It tells you a lot. Now it's a question of what do you do with the future?
Right, right. And I think, you know, I hate to use this phrase because it's overused as a trap game. And you know, if Maryland, let's say if Maryland had been last week and not this week, that might have been a problem. That might have been a real problem. You know, if you were going at Ohio State and then at Maryland, but you didn't. That's what the schedule is. The schedule, and I do think mentally, Penn State will be a lot sharper this Saturday at Maryland.
Rich, it is always a pleasure. You did this last minute. I really appreciate it. Thank you so much for all the great work.
Anytime, Steve. You know where to. You know you can ask me anytime. Thanks.
The outstanding Rich Scarcella, Reading Eagle. We'll wrap it up in a moment here on News Radio 1070 WKOK. All right. Today's show brought to you by Purdy Insurance. Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. Our thanks to John Griffin, the basketball coach at Bucknell. Our thanks to Rich Scarcella, Reading Eagle. And our thanks to Nate Bauer on 3.com for joining us on the show today. And Matt Cotrillo for his rant of the week, which I felt set the tone for every depressed person out there. Oh, sorry. Tomorrow, Neil Coulon's going to join us on the show. Looking forward to that. The Today Show, again, brought to you by Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. And we're in the Sunbury Motors studio. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15, almost Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. Here on News Radio 1070 WKOK.